Now today we are going to discuss about the concept of globalization. What is globalization? Globalization is a scenario which has brought the entire globe or the entire world. Imagine that this is a globe. This was made as a local village. In simple terms, globalization is nothing but globalization is making a globe into a village. The connectivity between east and west, north and south was wide and spread that it has reached the entire thing at very fast connectivity, and sharing has been spread not only in the forms of market or in the products or in the terms of anything, but even in the form of ideologies, or the ideas have been shared to a larger extent. Now, what is globalization for us right now? The globalization has brought changes not only in the political scenario, but also in the cultural and the environmental backgrounds of various places. We have seen in the earlier days, the transport of trade, the ideology of trade was an emerging concept in the olden days. The products were carried from one place to another place. In order to exchange the products, the people used to travel for miles and miles of journey, and then they used to sell their products there, used to get more profits by selling there, and then used to get back the money here. In this way, the trade was only concerned of the production of the product. The product was sold and we used to get more money. This was the earlier times. Second change which we got because of globalization was people. The people started to get migrated from one place to another place in search of better livelihood, or in search of better income earns, or better opportunities for them to learn and to aspire themselves. In this way, to cherish their lives, to set a standard of their living, to increase the standard of their living. This is the second major change what we got because of globalization. Moving on to the third concept, what we got is the flow of capital. Earlier, when we sell a product only, we used to get a flow of currency from one hand to another hand. But as the time passed on, as the moment changed on, now the people have started to investment from one region to another region. Now we have companies of America investing in India. We have Indian rich merchants investing in Europe, UK, France, Britain, Spain, New Zealand, Australia, in various corners of the world. These three changes have brought various changes in the entire globe. That is, the trade has brought of products earlier, got changed now. Then people started to migrate from one place to another place. And the third one is the flow of the capital from one region to another region also escalated the change of globalization into a very widespread region. And in the 20th century, we have seen some more major changes of spread of ideology. The rulers of Egypt, the rulers of Libya were overthrown by the people. The ideology of dictatorship was asked to be questioned, and the leaders of dictators were forced to leave their thrones, and the restoration of normal democratic setup was initiated because of this movement, which was aptly called by the media as the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring is the movement which was raised in the Arab continent region, or the regions of the Arab nations, which happened of Egypt and Libya. But this movement was not considered as successful by the historians because it does not escalated any great revolutions here. The only thing is the existing government was changed, or the other people were changed. The person was changed. It did not bring any major changes in their mindset or in their lives. Only the existing leaders were changed. This is the analysis given by this. But in this Arab Spring, the media played a vital role in Egypt or in Libya, which were owned by the other nation groups or foreign nation media, which escalated the issues and got an international support for that. Earlier, tsunami means we used to feel only sorrow for that. But today we can see what are the great destructions that are happened for us, and we can not only support by them, by our sympathy, but also through financial help, whichever is required for them, or by technological advancement by other nations, also brought change because of the globalization of media also. So media plays a very vital role, and globalization has connected each and every corner. Earlier we never used to know what is happening in other country, but today we can sit in our house and watching at the TV, we can clearly understand what is happening in the other region of the world also. Even now we can watch the FIFA World Cup, which is conducted in Brazil. We are very far away, continents far away from the region, but you can see the action live catching on the TVs. Now, how does an MNC work? What is the purpose of MNC? Why are they having a global attention in the entire world? See, MNC stands for multinational companies. See here, a multinational company is a company which utilizes the resources which are available at very less cost for them, and they can market their product globally. See, earlier we used to have the colonial masters who used to take away the product, and they used to sell their product at their places and return it back at very less cost for us. In return, we are not benefited much. But the MNCs are the companies which are doing marketing globally, but at the same time they are doing production also globally. To understand this scenario, we have an example here. A company which is having its base in US, especially a car company, Ford, take an example. So the research was done in US, like the design setup, the machinery, everything was done in US. Then it was sent to China to get the spare parts at very less cost. The machinery, the spare parts at very less cost. Then to assemble all the parts from China, the product is being shipped to Mexico and the other parts of European nations. Then after the parts are fixed and everything, then it is sent to globally to all corners of the world to sell it. And in the meanwhile, to get the customer support 24/7/365, we use the Indians who are pitched of excellent English clarity, and they provide excellent customer support throughout the clock. So in this way, if you understand the scenario very clearly, research is done somewhere, the manufacturing of the product is done somewhere, the fixing of the products is done somewhere, then marketing is done in the entire place, and for this the customer service support is getting from the other group of people. So this is the background of a multinational company. We have seen an example where the research work is done in the United States. Later, for making of the spare parts, the research designs are sent to China. In China, the spare parts are made. Again, from China, the spare parts are exported or shipped to Mexico, where they are experts in fitting in it. Then, after fitting the parts, then the product is exported to the various shops or outlets where they can sell the product. In the meanwhile, to have the connectivity with the customers, we started to use the Indian people as the customer service supporters. In this way, an MNC works by interlinking all the various products which are available at very less cost for them in manufacturing the product, and get the global output or a larger, wider market for them in order to sell their products. How do the MNCs establish themselves into their nation? Do they do purchases from one place to another place? Or how do they do the investments? See here, the investments of MNCs are done by purchasing the lands, purchasing the sites, or purchasing the buildings. This is the main motto which done by the MNCs. When MNCs are doing something, their main motto is that profit is their clear, perfect motto of doing all these things. When they started to do these kind of things, they clearly think and invest where they are going to get back their rupees finally back. Or otherwise, we have an alternative also, like they take up any one company which is locally in existence and they get added to this one. They combinedly took the share and then they export it or they capture that market. We have an example in India, like Cargill Foods, which is a base of US foods company, which started to buy the Parag Foods in India, which has edible oils as well as the foods which were made in India. Later, the Cargill Foods purchased the Parag Foods in India and entered into the Indian market, and today Cargill Foods are the largest producer of the edible oils in India. See, actually Cargill Foods is not producing anything by its own indirect, but it has purchased the leading company in India which is producing the edible oils and took over the share of the Indian market to its profit share. So in this way, the MNCs will try to grab the local markets as well as they get the international approach. So the Cargill Foods has purchased the Parag Foods, which owns 4 oil refineries and it became the largest producer of oil by purchasing the Parak Foods. This is an example how an MNC gets into the other products, or how an MNC expands its wings by taking over the other local things. The local markets also can be added as a share. We have one more example for us, that is the Ford company, which is a US based company, started to invest its investment of ₹1700 crores in 1995 with collaboration with Mahindra and Mahindra. The Mahindra and Mahindra is a local company in India. So it has to tie up with Ford to get an international market. So it has established a plant in Chennai with a huge investment, and by 2004 they were able to produce huge amount of Jeeps and vehicles of nearly 27,000 vehicles in 2004. Out of this, 24,000 vehicles are sent to South Africa, Mexico, Brazil and the other corners of the world and sold. So now Ford is an internationally renowned company for cars. At the same time, it has given a certain amount of due share to the local company called Mahindra and Mahindra. This Mahindra and Mahindra has got an international reputation by getting connected with Ford. So in this way, both the companies are benefited and got the global representation for them. In this way, the globalization started to play a very vital role, and this initiated the development of the policy of liberalization towards the world in 1990s. Because unless and until you don't accept the foreign revenues or the companies to come in and step in and to establish for them their investments here, we can't expect a foreign flow to come in for us. We can't expect a great jobs coming entering into us. We can't expect the change of the shift from a territorial agricultural primary sector into the secondary sector, then moving on into the service sector. Then only a country can develop into a well-developed nation through infrastructure, through job opportunities, through inflow of the currencies, to maintaining of the foreign currencies, to get the rapport between the different nations. It should be legalized, and the policy of liberalization has to be accepted in various corners. Then only an MNCs can enter into it. And as we are in the global village, we can't restricting ourselves into only our nation, our country, our state, our rules, our regulations. We have to adjust some of our rules and get the international approach, so that we also can get the benefits of internationalization or globalization. Now let us deal about the concept of liberalization. What is the meaning of the word liberalization? Generally, we have a word meaning liberal. Liberal means giving free hand. For whom we are going to give a free hand? The free hand what we are going to give is the liberalization of the foreign companies, for the foreign investments, what we are going to call the concept of globalization. Because of globalization, the maximum benefit what we are going to get is the inflow of the foreign currency into our nation. So the liberalization policies have made many of the foreign companies to invest in the other nations. When it comes to the investment, a huge investment can change the fate of a nation. And at the same time, when we are investing here, we have many barriers also. We have many restrictions also. We have heard the word like tax. The tax on the imports, when we are keeping more tax on the imports, this leads to a barrier for them. They don't bring the products to us because they need to pay more amount of tax. Automatically, the cost of the product will be increasing. That leads to the negative results for us. For example, on China products, we don't have any tax implemented, just only 10%, like 5 to 10%, we have only the tax. But at the same time, if you increase it for 20 to 30%, the extra amount of 10 to 30 is going to be an additional advantage for the person who is selling it, but at the same time, it is negative for the consumers who are buying it. Automatically, it leads to the increase of the cost of the product. Then the people, those are buying the product, will never be interested to take the product. So tax is a barrier for liberalization of the imports and exports. At the same time, when it comes to liberalization of foreign policy, Indians in 1950 to 60, that is in the initial periods of our independence, gave a liberalization only for few products like petrol, fertilizers and foods and seeds, because that is a moment or the key time when the industries are getting developed or transformed in the Indian scenario, and the first term plan and second term plans are going on, especially with the motto of developing our own industries like Tata Steel Industries and our Roorkela steel plant, all these things. So to block them, to give a boom to the Indian industries, initially Indian government did not allow the free hand for the liberalization policy on the foreign investments during the 1950s and 60s. Later in 1990s and in 1991 exactly, they brought the free liberalization hand policies for the foreign countries to invest in the Indian lands and to have the free hand over the issues. When it is brought in 1990s, many of the foreign companies started to invest in India, and at the same time many of the Indian companies also got a boom to get investments in the other nations, because once we don't have the tax barriers on the other barriers against it, we can get a free flow of money. And during this period 1990s, we need the economic recovery at a very high level or high point of time. That made the finance minister and the government of India during that period to think over the issue of getting the transformation, the liberalization policy. The entire world is getting liberalized into a one form or one unit. So definitely we also have to take a move towards that. Then only we can be in the race, otherwise we would be out of the race. This forced the government to take the liberalization policy in 1991 and open doors for the open market policy. This led them to get the investments from the other countries. In 1991, we got many of the investments. At the same time, we have an important issue to be discussed here. That is that which factors are going to influence the main key concepts of liberalization, or like what are the main crucial things which are going to get the investments. The concept of globalization has been institutions of global governance. We have various institutions to check over the global governance, or like the global markets, or like how is the investments going on in the various places or various countries. So for us, we need an institute which is to be checked, because they are not having their institutions in one particular nation, they are having in a group of nations. To make an overcome or to have a free and fair trade to be done in all the places, they have an established an international organization called World, as we are doing trade in the globalization, it's called World Trade Organization, which organizes everything. The World Trade Organization organizes the trade all over the world on the concept of globalization. Did you get the concept here? The World Trade Organization is nothing but which organizes the trade on the global scenario, which is an institute established only with the motto of covering the trade aspects of various nations. And to our surprising, we have the members of nearly 150 to 170 countries being the members of World Trade Organizations. In this again, we have the developing countries and the developed countries. They have their equal share representation, and the main target of World Trade Organization is that we should not have any trade barriers. We should have free and fair trade between all the nations, so that they get implemented and successfully they get interlinked with the trade. The free flow of the currency can be done with the products of exchange. This is the main motto of the World Trade Organization. In establishing this one, the motto was run with this main aim. Coming to the reality of the facts, that in India we have the agriculture is the main occupation of nearly 80% of Indians. How many? 80% of Indians get their basic livelihood from agriculture. But when it comes to the people of US, it is less than 1% of people concentrating on the income of agriculture. But at the same time, they own many lands. Their GDP percentage is only 1% of the investment what they are getting from agriculture. At the same time, the investment what is done for the Americans on agriculture is very high. They get in turn back also very high. Government only provides them loans for everything, minimum support price for everything, buy back the product and get investments done for them at very huge level. Now 80% of Indians are working hard. The GDP contribution is only up to 50 to 60% in the Indian GDP. Now Indians, automatically the Indian products are sold at very high price. But when it comes to the US agricultural products, as they are having many surplus amount and huge amount, they automatically sell it at very less cost, which means that the product which is costly, which is sold by the Indian people, the same product which is sold by the Americans is at very less cost. This is called trade barrier. Here we are having the trade barrier here, because Indians are forced to sell according to their currencies, but at the same time Americans are selling at their currency at very less cost. The World Trade Organization has to look after these kind of issues. In reality, the developed countries never bothered about the rules and regulations which are imposed by the World Trade Organization. In reality, in the fact conditions, many of the developing countries are forced to sign the agreements and forced to follow the rules and regulations of the World Trade Organizations. But at the same time, when it comes to developed nations like America, France, Britain, Russia and China, they were never questioned too much or forced too much to change this, because they have the veto power status in the UNO also. If any issue is raised, they can easily cancel it using their veto powers. There are many issues to be addressed. In reality and in facts, World Trade Organization is not sustaining to the exactly expected mark. Yes, many developed countries are following this. Many developing countries have raised their voices against this. let us see the issue to be addressed, and all will get a free and fair trade to be available at very comfortable levels. Let us see what is the impact of the globalization. What is the meaning of the word impact? How far we are getting influenced from this? What is the influence that we are going to get from because of the globalization? We have seen the people of Indians in the last 10 years or last 20 years, because of globalization, you are getting the better comforts. Better comforts. What is the meaning of the better comforts? You are getting the quality products at very less available cost. See here, better comforts, quality and less cost. In the better comforts, we are getting the things which we don't know from the last 10 years or never expected to be this, which we are getting here now at the very fine quality. The consumer has various options for us to get the things. At the same time, he is able to get the choice at very less affordable cost, where he can afford all these things. At the better comforts, in the sense, earlier we used to face summer, but we don't have the proper things, like we used to have only fans or coolers. Now we have ACs, we can regulate the temperature according to our choice. We can even heat temperature during the winter season. This is the better comfort. And the quality, we are having various companies in AC providers, which we are can guess, like Tata's, or we can get the Samsung ACs, we can get the Onida ACs. Different ACs are available for us to take a choice for that according to our ability. Or we can make a choice basing on our income also. We can put the less investment on that and get the product also for us. There are various issues. This has improved really the quality and the quantity of the people which are getting for us. The consumers are getting better benefits or better choices of their products. The producers have got huge investments from the MNCs. At the same time, they have got a huge markets. Earlier, they were confined only to a local area markets. Now they are having the international approach for them. And not only this, once when we come to the other benefits, what we got because of this globalization concept or the impact of globalization, we have many other issues also developed for us. Like, for example, let's take first, how is the people of the regions developed because of that? See here, the producers or the consumers or the person who is working will get a job or is provided a job, who is a skilled or an unskilled employee, then which leads for him to the development in getting the raw materials at very less cost. The impact, we are getting the raw materials at very less cost. Then once the raw materials are at very less cost, we get the company more profits. We are making the manufacturing units for profits. Then we are selling it internationally. When we are selling it internationally, then we are leading to many nations where we are going to get the flow of another nation's economy for us. And at the same time, our company is going to get an outer outlook. Like, for example, a company like Infosys. The Infosys company is earlier known only in India, but today it is known in various other countries. We have the companies like Ranbaxy. The Ranbaxy company is now a MNC company. Or even you take the paints like Asian Paints. The Asian Paints also today no more confined only to India. It is having its groups or offices all over the world. It's like it's an MNC company. The additional benefits what we got is we are getting quality assured for us at very less cost. We are getting employment opportunities, which leads for the profits for us, international connectivity, international marketness, and the international approach for us. And the next and the most important point, the second advantage what we are getting is our companies are getting the technological advancement. What is technological advancement? We have discussed earlier. Technology we are getting here because of the competition. The competition spirit made them to run behind it and achieve the success. Those who are success are in the competition. Those who are not run or not able to follow the competition, they are out of the race. So because of competition, they have reached their targets. They are growing in a larger speed. Earlier, to make 50 crores to 100 crores, it used to take some 100, like 50 years in a span of time. They used to make 50 crores into 100 crores. Today, less than 6 months, we are able to make 50 crores to double into 100 crores. Another 6 months, we are doubling it to 200 or 300 crores, basing on your competition, your effectiveness of handling the issues. These all are happening only because of the advancements which are happening in technology, the competitiveness, the spirit of the fighting, and the additional advantages what we got for our companies, and the international outlook. Earlier, we were confined only to our villages, our cities, our country, our state. But now, we are not at all concerned only with our nations. We are an internationally bounded persons. We can do everything, anytime, any place, and we can work for the things. Like, we have the people working for various things, like for Delhi Magazine. The Delhi Magazine example is the people are working instructions from London, they are getting it, and they are doing the publication of the magazine in Delhi. We are having call center jobs. Many of the companies of call centers are owned by the other people or like other nations. Many of the companies have their call centers in India or especially in Hyderabad, Bangalore or in the Bombay or in Delhi regions, where they cover by 24/7, 365 days, covering for the according to their holidays and their issues. So we have the advancement, we have the employment opportunities, we have the investments done, we have the technological issues done, we have the emailing technologies, we have the banking technologies, all have got rapid changes because of the impact of the globalization which we got on our country. This impact was positive in many changes. It has brought many effects on the people and the normal trends of the people. Earlier, a person getting a 10,000 salary was a very high risk and tough job. Today, there are people who are paid 10 lakhs to 1 crore of per month as per their capacity and the capacity builders according to their choices and their skills what they are paid. These all are advanced or brought up only because of globalization what we have, not because of any other issues here. So because of technology, these many positive trends are there. Yes, do we have some negative issues? We'll discuss with them. As we were discussing about the globalization, the impact, the positive trends and all these we have discussed. We have seen the technology inflow, the currency inflow. We have seen that people moving from one place to another place. All these are the positive trends of globalization. Let us see the other side of the coin of globalization. That is the next side or the negative side. Let it be better be negative side. The small producers who are producing in very small investments, what are they going to do? Are they going to cherish or are they going to perish? For example, if they can't compete with an MNC, see, a person like small person who is called named Ravi, who has started his company in 1992 at a place called Hosur, where his investment was very less. When it comes to the MNCs, the MNCs are having budget which is more than some of the developing countries. So it's a rough idea that they can invest even 100 crores to 200 crores on a single unit. But when it comes to a person like Ravi, who has invested in 1992 with a very less amount of some 10 lakhs, whose main capacity is that he builds capacitors. He builds the capacitors which are required for TVs, then for the electronic equipments, etc. So his idea was to cherish by making small units. He made the small units, he got the contracts, then he perished. Later in very soon, by 2000, he got nearly 20 employees working under him and his production was very good. In 2001, we got the World Trade Organization agreement, that removal of the barriers and free flow of trade. This has changed the fate of the small entrepreneur called Ravi, because this made the international market or international companies to enter into the Indian market. He is a man who is in Tamil Nadu, who is working for his capacities within a limited range. Once the international companies have brought their products, we know that they are having the design somewhere, product somewhere, making somewhere, issuing somewhere, customer care somewhere. So the product at most less cost, the MNCs do investments there. And they will bring the product at very less cost with high quality. So when it comes to Ravi's product, he is selling the product at very higher cost when compared to the product which is issued by the MNCs. This brought a clear breakthrough for Ravi's business. Now the investment of 10 lakhs has gone down completely. The number of employees were only just 7 and his production has been restricted only to the area where there is no influence of the MNCs. So the situation of the small entrepreneurs or the small producers when it compares to globalization impact is very high. Sometimes they compete to a very small extent, or sometimes they completely perish. They will be completely eliminated from the scene, because many of the friends who started along with Ravi were completely lost their business and disappeared from the scenario. But Ravi is like a bit capable of running the things at very smaller scale. So we have to understand the concept here. Globalization do impact the positives, but there are some negative points also which has to be taken into criteria. Like small entrepreneurs or small producers will be moved away or finished away with the impact of MNCs, which are playing their vital role in even the country's economy or on the political backgrounds of any issues. So we have to address the negative point of globalization. That is, the small entrepreneurs, can they compete or perish? They can't compete with an MNC. At the same time, they cannot sustain their growth standing against an MNC, which may lead to another controversy and may not be backed by any of the governments of the state or as well as the center. So we have many issues to be addressed. Let us go for the next concept, that is globalization, free and fair manner. Now, coming to the main important issue is that fair. Are we following the fair rules of globalization? Now the struggle is going on for fair issue of globalization. Globalization is really good. It gets the investment for us. It provides opportunities for us. It elevates the people. It brought the technology for us into day-to-day life. It brought more comforts for us. It brought more choices for us. It has many things for us, positives. We have seen the negatives, like small entrepreneurs, small people can't get the additional benefits. Now coming to the fairer issue here, are all the people getting the same benefits? For example, you see the skilled people are educated people. The educated people are bestowed with the best qualities of opportunities here. They are getting the maximum benefit what they can get. But when it comes to the uneducated people, those who are working as the laborers there, are they getting their wages properly done? If the wages are not properly given for them, whom has to be addressed here? A multinational company is having its head office somewhere in America and it runs it in India or in somewhere in Bangladesh or in Egypt or in Korea. Whom has to be questioned here? Are we going to get the answer for this? Are the Americans going to address the issue this seriously? Who has to take the serious action against it? The government or the World Trade Organization, which is set up with the purpose of fairer global rules and regulations, can make this issue a global scenario and make fairer rules. What is required for us is a fairer rules. The rules which are equal for all and benefits for all, not only for the rich people, not only for the powerful governments, even for the weak countries, the small nations, the developing countries, the workers of the developing nations should get the ability to talk and get their issues discussed and the problems to be solved completely to eliminate their issues. Because the fairer rules only can get the benefits for the wages of the workers, not anything else. And coming to the other issues, are the developed countries really following the rules and regulations here? For example, if you see the issue here, America have investment of 16% in the World Trade Organizations. And coming to the Japan and France, they have 3 to 7% each. And when it comes to the India and China, the influence is very less. Yes, do we have some vote majority here, but is the issue to be addressed clearly? Because the America word is final. The chairman or the president of World Trade Organization is elected by American president only, or nominated by the American president only. Most of the times they are Americans only. It means clearly evident that World Trade Organization is controlled completely by the Americans. And 16% of the investments are getting from the Americans. So most of the words are clear stands which made by the Americans only. They don't hesitate to follow the guidelines of the Americans, which means that the developed countries are restricting the developing countries to have their words up. This has to be addressed fairly. If this is not addressed fairly, very soon the developing countries are going to drip down. It may lead to a loss of the nations. Then the MNCs which are investing in that areas also may face the problems. So it should be addressed very seriously, and majority of the people may get be in troubles, and which may lead to another French Revolution where the employees have revolted against the workers who are not paid well, were revolted against them, who are not having the proper piece of bread for them available. So that may lead to any revolts. We can't predict any future if the problems are not solved seriously. Today we are in the modern period. A revolution can catch at any point, any moment, any situation without having any obstacles for it. And media has got its own hype, which any small issue can be created into an international issue and can be an international scenario here. And the other issue what is to be think is nationalism. Is globalization killing the concept of nationalism? Do you agree with this? Yes, there is some version listening to the obstacles that nationalism is no more present. We have an internationalism. We are not confined to any particular nation. These words are very good to listen and to understand it. But at the same time, every people have their own belonging to a particular nation. When we go and say to them that you don't belong to this nation, you have to belong to that nation, it does not mean fair to them. Yes, you have opportunities, you can acquire something, you can know the knowledge, you can acquire the ability, you can utilize the opportunities and get developed, move on, get advanced. It does not mean that we have to forget our motherlands. The globalization concept is a threat for nationalism. This nationalism has to be addressed very seriously. It does not mean that doing investment will curb the rights of the people belonging to that particular nation. Yes, we have the investments from the other countries only for the purpose of business and free and fair trade to be done for that purpose. It does not mean it's going to hurt the national feelings of any nation. Once it starts touching the national feelings Again, it may raise the other political issues that may lead to the political disaster or a revolution, which is another major threat which has to be addressed regarding the nationalism. And coming to the culture, what about the culture of a nation? Because we are having the rapid movement of the people from one nation to another nation in search of their jobs, which made them to get intermingled with other people, and sometimes people settled here. For example, we have people settled in India from various states to other states. In the same way, we have settled Indians in Canada, in UK, in Britain, in all these places, which does not mean that they have to forget their culture. Every culture has its own values and its own presence, its own flavor that should be preserved very carefully for the future generations.